I was born in Germany, in the town of Hindenburg, in the province of Silesia, and had a sister. She was 4 years older than I, and my father was a merchant. He had a store on Main Street, menswear, men's clothing, and my mother was a dentist. And everything seemed really very fine during my early childhood. Once Hitler came to power, everything changed, I mean, dramatically. The red banners all over with the swastikas and the strutting of the uniformed men through the streets. It was frightening. And my father used to purchase his merchandise in Berlin. And when he came back, he said Berlin really was much worse. They were picking up people and beating them. Mainly whoever was suspected of communism. Subsequently, they initiated all kinds of laws against the Jews, and it was a process. I mean, it didn't come overnight. But for example, my friends were beginning to shun me, and initially I didn't realize why, because we always had been friends and we always played together. But Hitler made provisions to get them into youth groups, and in these youth groups they were being indoctrinated. And they were asked to report, which my parents thought was a very frightening phenomenon. My parents were looking to leave Germany, but they were rather late. By the time they were ready to leave, all the Jews were ready to leave. But there were not too many countries that wanted to accept refugees. You also, our money also was blocked in a Sperrkonto, and my father was able to take out money, but he had to justify the expense for the rent, for his travels. But he had to ask permission to withdraw his own money. And he needed to get money into another country so that we could get to this country. Well, he eventually managed to get some money into Holland, in a bank in Amsterdam. The small countries were allowing for Jews to come in, the smaller European countries, but only in transit. You had to have a visa to immigrate to America or Australia or Canada, because they felt they are really small, relatively small countries. And of course, if you had relatives, for example, if you had relatives in Spain, and you could show that there was some connection to the Spanish culture, Spain was relatively easy to get into, but we didn't have a connection. We were a Zionist family, and we really felt that we wanted to go to Palestine, but the English, who had the mandate over Palestine, they made it very difficult, and they wanted, they didn't want merchants, they didn't want artists, they didn't want writers, they didn't want lawyers, they wanted skilled people, carpenters, auto mechanics, etc. And we just couldn't get what was then called a certificate. It's not easy for me to.
I know, it's not easy. You take your time, don't worry. There's not any rush, but I'm listening to you and don't worry at all. You're doing very well. Don't worry, Betty.
Suddenly, I mean, my father was already preparing. We had sort of decided that it was going to be the United States. And my father was preparing, and all of a sudden he got an expulsion order that he has to leave Germany within a month. And he knew some local officials, they were his customers, and he was able to prolong it a few days. But it was only for my father. It wasn't for my mother, and it wasn't for me or for my sister. And with that visa, he was able to get a transit visa through Holland, where he wanted to be because he had money there. And then he left. Mm-hmm. We had our affidavits for my mother and my sister and for me in June. It was quite amazing that he was able to do it, because in order to obtain the affidavit, you had to show that you have enough money to support the people that you are bringing over. But somebody lent my father the money. Just a man we met put $10,000 in my father's bank account, and my father had a couple thousand dollars, and that was enough money for us to be able to come to the United States. And my mother was going to Berlin, and trying to speed up the process. What she didn't know was that the process was supposed to slow down rather than accelerate. So my mother had to go to Berlin because she was told everything is now in order and we have the final documents that were needed. And my sister went to work in the morning, and I had a cold, or called it a grip, with a little fever, and my mother didn't want me to go to school, and I stayed home. I was in bed and reading, and about 10 o'clock in the morning, the doorbell rang, And there was pounding on the doorbell, and I went to the door, and there were police, Gestapo, about five of them, and they said to open up the door. I opened up the door, and I had the chain on, and they said to remove the chain. But everything was shouted in an order, and then five of those guys just trooped in, some in uniform, two I remember without uniform, just the armband with a swastika, and they looked very scary. I was in pajamas, and then they took out a piece of paper, and they said, "Oscar Weisberger," and I said, "That's my father. Where is he?" I said, "In America." And they said, "That's not possible. He's on the list." I said, "Well, he's in America." "And Ilona Weisberger, that's my mother. Where is she?" "She's in Berlin." "What is she doing in Berlin?" "I don't know." "And Eva Weisberger, that's my sister. She's working for Dr. Schaefer." And they said, "You come with us." And I was in pajamas. And I said, "I want to get dressed." "No, just come with us." So I managed to slip into a pair of shoes, and I pulled on a coat that was on a hook in the foyer, and on a clothes rack in the foyer, and I went with them. And there were two on either side of me, and one or two were left upstairs, or there were three next to me, and two, I don't remember exactly how many, but many. And what I remember is the bottoms of my pajamas were falling down. I was bending down and trying to bring them, to get them up. And people were looking at me, and I was crying. And they marched me through town and into prison. Well, it seems that my sister came home about 5 o'clock after work, and when she was about to open up the door was opened up from inside, and there was the Gestapo and policemen waiting for her. And she said that when she got near my cell, she could hear me screaming. You really have to read my book.
I can hear your book.
This is so difficult. Eventually, I was living in Warsaw. That was after the ghetto and after the liquidation of the ghetto. And I find it just too difficult to explain how I escaped and what it was all about, because I had a major problem. I didn't speak Polish well. I spoke German. And eventually, I had manufactured documents that I was a Polish girl, born wherever. But I didn't speak Polish well enough. And of course, I was Catholic. And I was with my mother. My sister, during the liquidation of the ghetto, and to this day, we really don't know whether she was killed, whether she was taken somewhere, but over 60 years, and we have to eventually came to accept that she doesn't live anymore, because we tried to find her after the war, and my father tried to find her. And just without a trace. Only after the war in the Holocaust Museum in Washington did I learn that the transport from that particular ghetto didn't go to a concentration camp like Auschwitz or Majdanek or any of the others. It went straight to a death camp, because they had established these death camps. Nobody knew about it, and the name of that death camp where this transport went to was called Belzec. And nobody who went on this transport survived. Not one single person. And I think it's just going to stay with me till I die. I don't really even think that I want to forget it. I think there are some survivors that are able to function better if they forget, but I can't. If I forget her, it would be as if she had never been here. A few months later, the Warsaw Ghetto rebellion, whatever you want to call it, started. And seemingly there were Jews escaping. And all over Warsaw they were hunting Jews. And I had a number of close ones, but managed to get away. I loved going to church, because that was a respite. And I write about it in my book, and people ask me, when I sometimes, I don't speak too much, but whatever, they say, they read my book, and they want to know whether I didn't feel uncomfortable being in a church. And I think this is such an unrealistic question, because a church is a place of worship, just like a synagogue is. And if God is within you, God is there. Hitler started initially with the communists, who then stopped being communists, and with the Jews, who couldn't stop being Jews. And the world, maybe, I'm not sure, other people will write about it, maybe the world was rather callous about that. But during this Second World War, 50 million people were killed. Now, it's one thing to be able to get killed in a battle where you stand up and you fight. You don't have that anymore. There's going to be other wars now. And another thing where you're forced down on your knees and you're not allowed to even breathe. So, but the fact is, 15 million Germans were killed in that war. 18 million Russians, 6 million Jews. I think it was a war that could have been prevented if the world would have wanted to take notice. But that's the conclusion I came to after a lot of reading, a lot of introspection. Mm-hmm. I would like to think that we, looking into the future, into a better world, but I don't see it. I see that we're making the same mistake of appeasement all over again. I left on that. Mm-hmm. May I?
Yes, Betty. Sure. Let me have it.
No. I'm good. I'm not on the street and you don't have any obstacles here. Do I look that sad? That's how you saw me. Well, it's definitely me. That's so sad. Was I so sad when I was talking to you?